On Nationwide this evening, with summer on the horizon, we visit the seaside town of Ardmore in County Waterford to meet the locals and visit the sites that attract people to this beautiful part of the country. We meet journalist and author Fergal Keane, who spent his summer holidays here since he was a boy. We visit a writer's retreat established in the name and memory of one of this country's best-known travel writers, Molly Keane. And we meet a man who spends his time foraging the coastline for goodies that can and are used in the kitchens of the land. You're welcome to Nationwide, and you're welcome to the picturesque coastal village of Ardmore in County Waterford. People have lived in these parts for thousands of years. It's actually believed that this is the earliest Christian settlement in Ireland. It's also a place that has always attracted writers and artists, among them BBC foreign correspondent Fergal Keane. And of course, writing is in his blood. He is the nephew of John B and the son of the actor Eamon Keane. And Fergal is no stranger to these parts. His maternal grandmother was born in Ardmore village, and he's been coming here on holidays since he was a baby. Well, recently he took us on a trip down memory lane around this place that he calls his second home.
In my own case, I was growing up in Dublin, and I came down here as a baby. I was a few weeks old, I think, when I first came. And coming back every August as a child, staying with my grandmother in a house on the main street, the thing to a city child was the freedom. I could leave that house in the morning after breakfast and roam for hours. Down in the rock pools below us here, there are five local beaches. I'd roam across them. I'd hang around with a large gang later when I was a teenager, and we could go and be free in a way that you could never imagine being in the city. That was, I think, the essential magic for a young person here. In the old days, the old Cliff Hotel, where we used to sneak in and watch the Rose of Tralee and then wait to be thrown out, and half the thrill was waiting to be thrown out and caught, because it was the only television around where you could see things. My great-grandfather was a peeler, an RIC man here. He was a sergeant in the local barracks. My grandfather was born here. So I don't feel quite like a blow-in. Now, to be a true local, of course, you have to be able to trace your genealogy back several centuries, probably to the time of the Vikings. But I think they're just about getting used to me. I think what Ardmore has very successfully done is keep the worst of the modern world at bay. And there was a huge fight here some years back over the scale of development and what was sensible and what was appropriate. And I think a very spirited defence of the landscape of Ardmore, this extraordinary special landscape, that defence was mounted by local people and kept the specialness. And you don't have widespread entertainment complexes here, for example, like you do in some other local places. The entertainment that you find is very much what you make on the beach or walking the cliffs or the off up in the Comera Mountains. There's so much here that is natural. You don't need the false or the pretend. Here we are in the oldest Christian settlement in Ireland. It's a remarkable place. When I was doing a television history of Ireland, I was asked by the producers in advance of doing it to draw up, you know, the most significant events in Irish history. And the executive producer came back to me and he said, this is really interesting, Fergal, but it's amazing how many of the great events in Irish history seem to have happened in Ardmore. Of course, it was very deliberate on my part. I wanted to film as much as I possibly could here. But, you know, that's only half joking. You know, it is a place where we had St. Declan, a really, really influential figure in the early Irish Christian church. A place where, during the Cromwellian era, we had a siege and a massacre here, which typified in many ways the kind of extreme violence that was taking place at the time. In more modern times, it has become a place for writers, for poets. Molly Keane, for example, Patrick Coburn, my great colleague, the Middle East correspondent of The Independent. It's a place that allows people to be creative and imaginative, and I think get in touch with their essential selves. There's no nonsense here. And I think if you were inclined to have any illusions about yourself, you'd be put right pretty quickly by the locals. Goat Island was where my grandfather built a house in the 1930s. He built a cottage there. And my mother and her siblings came every summer to Goat Island. A special place for them, and she handed on through telling her stories of what it was like growing up there, she handed on the love of the place. And I go back there with my own children. My son Daniel, I think, was 3 weeks old when he first was brought down to Goat Island, and he's going back there now with his friends. The range of landscape here, you know, you've got beautiful wide open beaches, you've got that rocky cliff face. You could spend weeks here and not see or experience all of it. And that gives you the excuse to keep coming back. The reason people come here is for the simplicity and the eccentricity. It's always drawn eccentrics, provided a home for them. And people love that. And, you know, if they want entertainment in a glitzy way, there are plenty of other places along this coastline for them to go to. I think Ardmore's secret is its simplicity, and that will endure because it's what people want. One of the things that I have seen grow in Ardmore in my own time is a very active community spirit. Now, there was always a community spirit, but what you see, particularly in something like the Tidy Towns Committee and in other areas as well, is people coming together and trying to improve this community and make it more attractive to outsiders. For example, at the moment, they're bringing out guides, interactive guides to Ardmore, a map telling us the history of Ardmore. And all of that work is done right throughout the winter by people meeting in committee rooms. And it's a symbol of something that I think is so hugely important to us in this period of economic stagnation and recession. And that is the idea that you're not going to wait for governments to sort out the gloom that's around us. You take it into your own hands. And they're doing it here with great, great effect. This is where I'd like to be laid to rest. It's where I feel I belong. And I live a life that's, in many ways, is full of transience, of movement, travelling from place to place, airport after airport, hotel room after hotel room. And to have a place where you feel you belong is very, very important. This is it.
Isn't Fergal's passion for Ardmore just infectious? And sure, is it any wonder? The whole place is spectacular, with sandy beaches surrounded by rugged cliffs. It's also a great place for wildlife, with flora and fauna and edible plants. And you know, foraging was once quite common in Ireland. Helen McInerney actually recently met up with a modern day forager who harvests the best that the Waterford coastline has to offer.
Andrew Malcolm is a regular on this beach near Ardmore in County Waterford. Undeterred by the blustery conditions, Andrew is collecting edible greens for the nearby Cliff House Hotel. The coastline is a rich resource for foragers like Andrew, but he says you must know what you're doing.
This plant is, I call it sea spinach, but technically it's actually called sea beet. But you cook it more or less, well, I cook it more or less the same way as you cook spinach. Just wash it and rinse it. To the very uninitiated eye, it could look like a dock leaf, but it's a very succulent plant. It grows all the way along the coastline here in Waterford.
Another popular edible coastal plant is rock samphire.
I'm just collecting some rock samphire here, which is another great coastal plant that the chefs like very much. I think it goes accompanies a lot of fish dishes. Most people associate the seaside with seaweed to eat, and perhaps winkles and cockles and limpets and things like that. But I've always been interested in plants. I've always just been interested in plants it's been fascinating discovering just how many different species of edible plant there are on the seashore. So a chef just gave me a call and asked if I'd bring him along some of this plant, which is very prolific at the moment. It's called three-cornered leek. So I'm just going to collect him some flowers because he's a special type of guy and I like him so much.
Andrew is no newcomer to foraging. He has spent the past 20 years educating himself about the different edible wild plants.
Well, obviously you have to be very cautious if you're doing this yourself. And either, you know, I mean, I've been doing it for a lot of years and I've built up the knowledge very gradually. So every year I almost learn one, I set myself to learn one or two new plants or one or two new mushrooms. so that I'm very, very careful that of what I'm getting from the start. Mostly I've learned from books and being very cautious about what I'm doing and taking a little bit of it. Even when I've cross-referenced it over, I tend to cross-reference over books and in the internet and looking at things.
His family moved from Portrush in Northern Ireland to Lismore in County Waterford in the early 80s. He loves to work with his hands and with natural materials. His home is a restored barn in the grounds of his parents' house near Lismore.
We all came down in 1984 from Portrush, and my dad, as I say, I was brought up in a family, because he was Scottish, so you could say he was mean, but he budgeted well, let's say, put it that way. But he was doing recycling before anybody was doing recycling, and that's how I've been brought up, and I've kind of lived pretty much like that all my life. The barn had nothing in it at all. It was just the four walls, and I had to do the whole thing really up myself.
Andrew is the original multitasker. He loves to build with stone, to grow plants, to take photographs, to play music, and he makes guitars.
Yes, the old sort of jack of all trades and master of none.
I'm sure that's not true.
I think it probably is, but I'm not anything specific, but I think that's to do with the type of person that I am. I think some people choose a career. A friend who said that people are either horizontal or vertical, and she said, I'm a horizontal person. I do try lots of different things. Other people are vertical people, and they're focused on one specific thing.
It took some time for him to find a chef who appreciated the wild, edible plants he was collecting. And when the Cliff House Hotel opened in Ardmore, he saw his opportunity.
I just came in not too long after they finished the hotel, I think, but it might have been a couple of years after. It's probably 2 or 3 years ago. I called in and asked, sort of, could I speak to the chef? And went down and met Martin and asked him if he'd be interested in mushrooms and things. And he said, yeah, that he'd also be interested in plants.
It was welcome that he came in because, you know, I'm Dutch and I came to Ireland and I explored Ireland and want to adapt to the culture and their eating habits. And I always worked with local suppliers as maximum as possible. And I did foraging a little bit myself as well, but I just don't have the time for it. But also I do not have the local knowledge. He just offered himself and slowly, you know, you build a relationship. He brings in, you know, several little bits and pieces and he knows a little bit what I want. This is gold because you can't buy this. You know, this is not something which you can buy off the shelf. It's in season. It is picked by someone who lives and learns in the locality about nature and is really connected with it. And he offers something what he finds. And I think it's a learning curve, not only for ourselves, but also for our guests.
The chef puts the sea beet into a dehydrator, then a blender, and turns it into a powder.
And the powder is very fragrant. And what we did, we cured the salmon with cork dry gin, and we coated into the sea beet. So we always try to use the maximum of possible with the ingredients we have.
The sea spinach and the tree-cornered leek are then turned into a vegetable pate.
So now we're just going to build up the dish with all the little bits and pieces. So then as well, do a little bit of the powder, also around the plate. You see the dish slowly comes really alive. You see all those colors. That's it. And then we smoke it. And again, you don't have to put much in it because, you know, they all have their own characteristic flavor. So that goes out to the table, and then that's it.
That was interesting. A word of warning, though, for budding foragers. There are, of course, poisonous mushrooms and plants, and you've got to know which ones are edible and which ones are not before you have a go. We're going to take a break now. When we come back, Irish novelist and playwright Molly Keane, who lived here in Ardmore and whose home is now a writer's retreat. We'll talk to you again in a couple of minutes.
These smart watches make you
really fit. So, am I fit now?
Want to know more about connected health? At Harvey Norman, we'll show you how. call in store or see harveynorman.ie/connected health.
You're welcome back to Nationwide and you're welcome back to the picturesque seaside village of Ardmore in County Waterford. Now the people here take great pride in this place. They consistently do really well in the Tidy Towns competition and they actually won it outright in 1992. And this place is also beloved of artists and writers. The Irish novelist and playwright Molly Keane lived here for 50 years. I suppose she's best known for her novel Good Behaviour, which was a runner-up in the Booker Prize. Well, Molly's home overlooking Ardmore Bay is now a writer's retreat and Helen McInerney has been there to visit.
Tucked into the hillside, high above Ardmore Bay, is the home of Irish playwright and novelist Molly Keane. She lived here for almost 50 years until her death in 1996. Today her cottage is run as a writer's retreat.
So with the inner landscape, we close our eyes for a moment. Just see what's going on inside for you this morning as you arrive here into Molly Keane House.
Molly Keane was born in Kildare in 1904 into an Anglo-Irish gentry family. She was first published in the 1920s under the pseudonym M.J. Farrell, but came to public prominence in 1981 when her book Good Behaviour was shortlisted for the Booker Prize.
I wish I could realise it. I'm terribly grateful for it. But I just don't understand. I don't understand why it was a success. I do have a sort of idea. It was because it's really rather a voyeur's kind of book. I mean, you're looking over the shoulder of someone who doesn't know what's going to happen.
She was so excited. She had such a fun. She really made the absolute most of her the big success she got in her old age. You know, I often tell the story about how I'd be sitting there like a kind of cross granny at midnight thinking, what's happened to her? Has she had a stroke? Where is she? And she'd come in, you know, all sort of a little bit tipsy and I'd be looking at my watch and glaring. It's a role reversal.
Molly Keane's success as a writer in her late 70s may have taken some people by surprise, but she had been a successful novelist and playwright in her youth. It was the sudden death of her husband, together with a bad review of one of her plays, that prompted Molly to give up writing, leave her home in Cappoquin and move to Ardmore.
Then she kind of threw herself into life here, domesticity, gardening, social life. She was very creative in, you know, many other fields, not just with the writing.
The book Good Behaviour may never have been published, but for a visit from Molly's great friend, Dame Peggy Ashcroft.
She came to stay and she got flu. And it was me and Sally were married and away and everything. And she said, come on, Molly, I don't believe you or not. You haven't been writing anything. And somehow she convinced Mum. She got out the manuscript of Good Behaviour. Peggy read it and absolutely loved it. And then one thing led to another.
Molly Keane was a very sociable person and her daughter Virginia believes her mother would have enjoyed her house being used as a writer's retreat.
She was so open to people, you know, and enjoyed people so much. I mean, one of the things that's lovely about what we're doing with the writer's retreat is the fun, and not just the fun, but the... I just find it very rewarding. I find people's response to her and her writing very moving, and also I love people's response to the house, which I love.
Following Molly's death in 1996, her family decided to keep her house in Ardmore, and it was a chance meeting with a writer in the area that led to it being set up as a writer's retreat.
She brought me to the house for dinner one night. And I'd just come back from Tyrone Guthrie Centre in Annamacarrick and I'd had a beautiful, you know, 2 weeks writing up there. And when I saw this house, it seemed to me like a miniature Tyrone Guthrie. I just think that Ardmore is so beautiful and so inspiring and it's inspired so many writers. And I thought, well, you know, Virginia said to me, we rent the house for families for holidays, but no, the recession and that. And I looked around the house and I just thought that it was such a waste not to have the heritage of Molly Keane and all that she did here, writing the, you know, good behaviour. And then the local arts officer, Margaret Organ, has just been hugely supportive. So we just started off doing a Writers' Week in August. And we just started off very gently. And we had, you know, very good writers then coming on the Saturday as guests.
I grew up in Ardmore, actually, just over the road. And I remember Molly when I was a very young girl. And I was always fascinated that there was a famous writer living so close. And she was so nice, so friendly. She was always cheerful, always full of the joie de vivre. She was always in good form. And I always remember her with her little dog, Hero. She always had little Hero with her. And I was delighted when I saw the course advertised, because I was delighted that I got a place in it. And I did the first course and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'd recommend it to anybody.
I feel as if I'm home here. I've been here before. I was here the first year or two when Virginia, Molly's daughter, opened this house to invite people like me to come and write. And, you know, there's a sort of dreach, the magic to the place.
Very enjoyable, relaxed atmosphere. People learn from one another, give each other tips on the writing. Thoroughly enjoyable and very, very relaxing.
Some people were writing then for memoirs, some people were writing to publish, some people were writing for their children, people writing for themselves, and it was all included. And that's why I think, and of course the house is such a setting, that, so, you know, there's an aura and an ambience of writing in the place anyhow, you know, and the gardens, the surrounds, fabulous place, you know, and they're really, really conducive to a good week.
Award-winning documentary filmmaker Kevin Brownlow, who is married to Molly Keane's daughter Virginia, will host a film day in May.
Virginia thought it would be interesting to show silent films, which don't often get seen these days, and so I gave a talk about the Irish influence on Hollywood, my favourite subject. And on May the 11th, I'm going to do one about the gangster film in the silent era. And the Irish connection there is very strong as well, on both sides of the law. And then September 14, I'm going to do one about the sailing ship, which the silent era preserved most beautifully and excitingly. Even fellow up the top of a mast filming in the worst storm of the century. So that'll be very exciting.
In a way, doing this has had slightly the same effect on a smaller scale as Mum's big success with being a runner-up for the Booker, in that, you know, I encounter all sorts of people that I find really interesting and exciting and that I enjoy very much.
And then I thought, well, I'll have a house by the sea. It'd be nice for them. All their boyfriends would be able to sail or row the boat or go fishing or catch prawns or something more for them to do than in a large, rather derelict country house that all the money is going on.
So you're happy here?
Oh, I love it. I love the people in Ardmore. They just are changelessly dear.
The spirit of Molly Keane lives on in her home place and continues to inspire writers today. And if you'd like to find out about some upcoming courses, well, the address is on your screens now. And that's it from us for this evening. I hope you've enjoyed our visit to Ardmore in County Waterford. And if you've never been here, put it on your list. It's a lovely, unspoilt holiday location. Wonderful for children. Loads of sandy beaches. Agus bemba the rashta veragadeen marshin, patishin, iwagwif, agus gadesha son.
On next Wednesday's Nationwide, a helping hand in troubled times. We meet brother Kevin Crowley to find out about the work at the Capuchin Day Centre in Dublin, where they provide meals for hundreds of people who may otherwise go without. We've a spotlight on the work of the homeless agency Focus Ireland, and the enigmatic Jesuit who continues his lifelong campaign against poverty.